to Be an Extraordinary Leader, sponsored by Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White, and I'm the Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services here at Georgetown, and our presenter today is Celine Brillet. To begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar in about 5 business days on our website. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you're welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Please feel free to close some of these applications out or join us simply using the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area of your GoToWebinar control panel screen. Celine is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A component of the presentation. We will also be emailing out the PowerPoint slides afterwards. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter today. Celine is an International Coach Federation certified executive coach who works with leaders who want to take themselves and their teams to a higher level of success, achievement, and fulfillment. Celine has worked and lived in 11 cities across 4 continents. She has worked as an auditor, consultant, investment banker, private banker, sales manager, and executive coach. Her experience with transitions enables her to support her clients in taking the right risks to move forward in their personal transition process and to achieve their desired outcomes. Celine has received a Bachelor's of Science in International Business and Finance from Georgetown University and a Master's of Business Administration from INSEAD. She is a graduate of the Coach University Core Essentials Fast Track Program and Advanced Corporate Coaching Program. She is licensed to facilitate the Coaching Clinic Workshop, Corporate Coach University. I want to thank Celine in advance today for her time, and I'm going to turn it over to her.
Great. Thank you very much, Emily, for the introduction. I'd like to begin to wish you all a very happy new year. May 2011 be prosperous, both personally and professionally for all of you. Thank you, everyone, for participating in today's webinar. I chose this topic because, as you know, I'm a leadership coach, and more I'm seeing the need for extraordinary leadership. I think this is primarily driven by the need for rapid change, a lot of innovation that we're seeing in today's business environment, and a real desire to move away from the status quo, to move away, obviously, from the economic crisis, and to achieve better results than we've seen in the last year and a half or 2 years for some organizations. My intention today is to share with you some ideas about what exceptional leadership looks like, and I'll also be sharing some tips on how to become an exceptional leader. And I'd like to request something of you, if I may. I'm going to ask you not to be too disappointed if you notice that you don't have all the traits that I'll be describing later on in this presentation. I'd like you to keep in mind that leadership is really an art. It's not a science. And again, as a leadership coach, I work with a lot of leaders, some very senior executives, who are working on all these traits and continue to work on these traits to improve themselves. So certainly don't feel like you're not up to the task because you might not meet one or two or more of these traits. It's all about work in progress. And I also look forward to your questions at the end of the session. So let's get started. The outline that I've created for the presentation today is as follows. I'm going to start out by describing what leadership is. It's a term that I'll be using, obviously, quite often in today's presentation, so I'd like to define that for you. Then I'll look at why we need exceptional leadership. I think we need exceptional leadership, so I'll be trying to convince you about the importance of exceptional leadership, particularly in today's environment. I'll also be looking at the 10 traits of exceptional leaders. What do they have that makes them exceptional? What does one need to have to be an exceptional leader? And then I'll be providing you with a short summary of these tips. Before we get started, I wanted to share with you free gifts that I'll be offering to you at the end of the webinar presentation. So the first one is the presentation itself, which Emily has already mentioned will be circulated to you in the next 5 days, will be available to you, rather, in the next 5 days. I'd also like to make available to you a report that I've written on the 10 traits of exceptional leaders. You'll also have the possibility to subscribe to a biweekly newsletter, which I write around the topic of leadership. And it's really tips to help leaders improve their professional and personal effectiveness. And lastly, a strategy session. This is really a complimentary one-hour session that will help you or us together explore your current situation, the challenges that you might be facing, and opportunities which you might not have seen. You'll leave the conversation with a lot more clarity about the issues that you're facing, and certainly with a few ideas on how to help you achieve these goals. So at the end of the presentation, I'll let you know how you can go about redeeming these free gifts. All right, so let's get started. Let's start by looking at the distinction between management and leadership. I know a lot of people use these two terms quite interchangeably, and I really want to create a distinction between the two. So management is really about planning and budgeting. It's really looking at existing resources and identifying how to maximize those resources. Leadership, on the other hand, it's about setting direction. It's really about developing that vision, looking at the big picture and determining where the organization needs to go. Management is about organizing and staffing. It's ensuring that the right people are in the right place. Leadership is about aligning people, ensuring that there is an alignment with the overall vision, that people actually feel like they adhere to the corporate values, to the strategy of the organization. Management provides control and solves problems. We typically associate management with compliance, with some form of monitoring as well. Leadership, on the other hand, provides motivation. It's really about creating an environment where people feel compelled and are interested in giving their best and performing at their optimal level. I've included a quote here by John Cotter. The real challenge, he says, is to combine strong leadership and strong management to use each to balance the other. So what he's saying here is that there really is the necessity for a leader to look at both sides of the equation, the leadership and the management side. And both are what create ideal leadership styles. Let's spend a little bit of time now looking at a couple of leadership myths. The myth number one that I wanted to offer to you is that leadership is innate. As a leadership coach, you can imagine how I feel about this particular topic. As you can imagine, I strongly believe that leadership can be learned. This is the type of work that I do, as I mentioned earlier, with a lot of leaders out there, is to help them improve their potential areas of limitation and also focus on their strengths. But leadership is something that can be learned. A leader is infallible. A lot of times we associate a leader to a superhero almost, somebody who does not make any mistakes whatsoever. I think we've all been exposed to leaders in the past who have made mistakes, some of them who've recognized the mistakes, others who haven't. But clearly, a leader is not infallible. The third myth is that a leader has all the answers. In typical traditional leadership models, there's the belief that leaders are experts, that they have all the knowledge. After all, this is why they are in leadership positions. But the complexity of today's business environment and the rapidity of change really indicates that it's impossible for a leader to have all these answers. The business environment is far too complex, and no human being can actually meet the standard. So it's unlikely that a leader would be able to have all the answers, or who might have even had that experience of a particular situation in the past. This is what the business environment is like today, just full of complexity. So I keep talking about exceptional leadership. Why do we actually need exceptional leaders? Exceptional leadership is necessary to navigate rapid change in uncertain times. It's really about the ability to be flexible, the ability to change course as necessary, to promote innovation and retain a competitive advantage. Keeping up with industry changes and keeping up with competition requires innovation, requires a great deal, actually, of innovation. This is through new products, new processes, different ways of doing things. To increase the level of loyalty and engagement in organizations, As we all know, the economic crisis has led to a lot of skepticism and certainly some disillusionment, particularly because of a lot of organizations have had to downsize. So today there's a real need to bring about more engagement to regain that loyalty, company loyalty. Leaders often work with teams who have more expertise or technical knowledge than them. This happens so often, where the leader is not the one with the most experience, with the most knowledge. Their subordinates are. To maintain the highest standards within a firm, and that one is fairly straightforward, to help individuals achieve their full potential. Unless people are truly challenged and they feel valued and appreciated, they will not perform at their maximum potential. And to obtain better results, this one is obviously very straightforward. Here's some more reasons why it's necessary. People need to feel inspired, as money might not be enough as a single motivator. As a coach, I find that people are looking for a deeper meaning in their jobs. They're looking to make a greater contribution. They're looking to leave a legacy. And money isn't sufficient as a single motivator. Take the organization to the next level. That one is fairly straightforward as well. Results are achieved through motivating and coordinating the actions of others. A leader is not an island. Results will come through the work of many individuals. So it's important to coordinate and motivate those individuals. And lastly, vision, new ideas, these are all found at different levels of the organizational hierarchy. And this is why exceptional leadership is needed, to be able to harness and identify those new ideas and those visions that may be coming again from different levels of the organization. So let's go into the 10 traits of exceptional leaders. Let's look at what these exceptional leaders have. And this obviously comes from the work that I've been doing with my clients and experiences that I'll be sharing with you today. So first of all, a leader is visionary. And this means the ability to set, but also to communicate a compelling vision. This is probably one of the most obvious traits of a leader. There's a twofold point here that I want to underline. First of all, it's about setting a vision, but it's also the ability to communicate that vision. A vision is primordial because this is what gives people the clarity around where an organization is headed. People need to feel inspired to move in that direction. Sometimes they may have to move in that direction and they feel compelled to move in that direction, even though it might not meet their immediate short-term interests. A vision also ensures that actions of all individuals within the organization are coordinated. Everyone is moving in the same direction. So in essence, by listening to leaders' vision, individuals can truly identify with this vision. They find it really compelling. They're drawn to it. And it really generates the necessary enthusiasm and the emotion that will compel them and convince them to take action. So how do you go about setting a compelling vision? I've indicated here a list of aspects of a vision, which is by John Cotter, that will give you a sense for how to go about deriving a compelling vision. First of all, a compelling vision needs to be imaginable. This means that individuals can almost picture it in their minds. It's something very vivid. It's an image that they can look at and they can see the organization going to. It needs to be desirable. It needs to include the best interests of the major stakeholders, clients, shareholders, and also employees. It needs to be feasible. This is a very important point. There's nothing more discouraging than a vision that is completely unattainable and unachievable. There needs to be focus, which means that individuals need to have the necessary clarity to help them make decisions to move towards that vision. It also needs to be flexible, so it can't be a vision that's too rigid, where people can't make their own decisions, where they can't take some personal initiative. And lastly, it needs to be communicable. This means that individuals will probably be communicating that vision to their subordinates, to people within the organization, maybe even to people outside the organization. So in order for it to be truly compelling, a vision needs to be easily communicable and easily explained. Let's look at trait number two, achiever. Extraordinary leaders have a drive to achieve beyond expectations. This is not only their own expectation, but it's also everyone else's expectations. They're always looking for challenges. They love to learn. They approach issues creatively, and they take a real pride in a job that is well done. I think we've all experienced extraordinary leaders, the type that has a lot of energy, that's always restless in a status quo situation. And this energy tends to be almost contagious, and I think you all know, or you can all relate to what I'm talking about. They also set the performance bar very high, both for themselves and also take the organization with them in that high performance bar. So how do you challenge yourself and others to achieve more? So I invite you to consider how passionate you are about your role and responsibilities. It's difficult to be passionate, and it's difficult to have that desire to achieve beyond expectations if you don't feel really compelled by your role and your responsibilities. Think about how you might be able to raise the performance bar to challenge yourself, to challenge others even more than you're doing right now. And this is one that's particularly challenging, and I see this a lot with the people I work with, which is to keep your optimism and your creativity even when faced with adversity. It's so easy to go down that downward spiral when things go wrong or when things aren't going as you're expecting them to. But exceptional leaders know how to remain optimistic. They know how to come up with creative solutions even when they're faced with adversity. Focus on one clear goal. A lot of leaders tend to focus on a number of goals at the same time, obviously stretching themselves too thin and creating somewhat of a havoc situation for their subordinates. Extraordinary leaders know to focus on one clear goal at a time. This helps people working for them feel more motivated, feel more engaged. And lastly, divide action plans and check-in points that help you achieve that specific goal. These are milestones. These are ways to measure that you're really moving along within the context of your vision and the goal that you're trying to achieve. So milestones are very important, and clear action plans. Third trait is being self-aware. What does it mean to be self-aware? People with strong self-awareness are honest with themselves and with others. They know how their behaviors affect others. They know how their behavior affects their environment. Self-aware individuals recognize that they have human qualities, and with that, the strengths and weaknesses that come along. They know what their limitations are inside out. For instance, a leader may know that if they don't get their answers, their questions answered quickly, they might get very frustrated. They know that they're very impatient when it comes to getting questions answered. So not only are extraordinary leaders cognizant of their strengths and weaknesses, they're also very comfortable talking about these limitations, talking about their strengths. They know that exposing a weakness really establishes trust amongst their team, and it helps people get on board. People feel that they have a role to play, a contribution to make. This may be a real challenge for certain leaders, and I've seen this quite a bit in the coaching work, where there is a sense that if you open up or if you share too much weakness, that you'll appear vulnerable. And this is something that for some leaders out there is a real challenge, how to show some weakness, which is something that they're certainly not used to doing either personally or professionally. But again, it really establishes trust and credibility with individuals. It enables individuals to really relate to the leader. Self-aware leaders have an understanding of their values and goals, and this helps them make the right decision. It's almost like a framework that they have in place. For instance, they know that if they're choosing between two new roles, it's really not about the greater financial reward. They know that this will not suffice to bring them personal fulfillment. This is where their values come into play. So how do you develop self-awareness? I invite you to gain a deep understanding of your emotions, of your strengths, of your weaknesses, of your needs, and of your drives. And sometimes this is something that we're very cognizant about, and other times it's something that we're not even comfortable saying out loud to ourselves or thinking about. but I invite you to really gain a deep understanding of these and start sharing some of these strengths and weaknesses with others. I referred earlier to this leader who might get very impatient when he doesn't get his questions answered. Imagine what impact that might have on a team if somebody actually were to say that, that they are impatient, that they need answers quickly. Not addressing this can create a negative impact on the team and can upset the team dynamic. So imagine what the impact would be of actually revealing this type of weakness. Notice also how your feelings impact you, other people, and also your job performance. And recognizing your mistakes quickly is a way to also develop self-awareness. This is one that is a real challenge for certain individuals as well, to actually admit to mistakes and admit to them quickly as opposed to ignoring them. And lastly, ask for help or delegate to address limitations. Once you become very aware of your limitations, of your potential weaknesses, ask others to help you or invite others to take on those responsibilities which you might not be able to do as successfully. Asking for help is a challenge for most people personally, so you can imagine how professionally that might be a real difficulty for some. But it is a very good way to overcome and address some of these limitations. So the fourth trait is around being social, displaying social skills. Remember that a leader's task is really about getting work done through other people. So you can imagine that leaders who work independently are just not as successful. But I want to emphasize here that it's not just about being friendly or being outgoing. It's really about being able to move people in a particular direction, convincing people about a change initiative, convincing them about new product launches. So it really goes beyond just being friendly and being outgoing. It's the ability to deploy those influential skills. Exceptional leaders also have networks in place. They're very well networked within the entire organization, and they know that these networks are in place for when the time for action comes. They know who to contact, they know who to speak to. This is a real trait of exceptional leaders. How do you develop social skills within the work environment? So my first invitation is to commit to deeply understanding the individuals you interact with, and also trying to identify what might be the trigger points that influence them. People are influenced by different things. Some people in the work environment are influenced by power. Other ones are influenced by people, meaning they want the benefit, the maximum benefit for people. So really understand what are the trigger points. This will help you in discussions. This will help you in influencing them to your point of view. Build bonds widely within the organization. As I mentioned before, having the ability to have connections both within your team but also within the larger context of the organization can be very effective for a leader. And be genuinely curious and interested in others. Ask questions. Get to know people on a deeper level. It's really about connecting with individuals. The fifth trait of an extraordinary leader is developer. An extraordinary leader knows that by putting people first, results will automatically ensue. Extraordinary leaders help their teams learn and grow. The last thing they do is solve their challenges, because they know that if individuals solve their own challenges, this will foster accountability, initiative, creativity, and commitment. People will not take ownership of their roles if someone else is stepping in every 5 minutes and solving their problems. What they'll typically do is defer decisions and actions to their leaders, and they'll become very disengaged with their roles and responsibilities. An exceptional leader might also have to put her ego aside in order to allow for the development of the people. The temptation for a leader is to intervene in day-to-day issues, and sometimes even to interfere, because they believe that they know better. They have more experience, they have more knowledge, they have more expertise. But I'd like you to consider that this type of behavior is really effectively robbing a team member of a potential learning opportunity if somebody else is stepping in and taking ownership of a problem or of a challenge. Focusing on people development leads to employee retention and increased company loyalty. As you know probably very well, when people feel that they're being developed, they're given the opportunity to grow and to learn, when they feel challenged, when they feel valued and appreciated, this is what will compel them to remain with a particular organization. This is what will create that motivation and also that retention. So how do you develop people? First of all, notice your temptation to solve your team's problems, your temptation to step in, to save the day, to show your expertise. Just notice it initially. Then challenge your team to come up with their own answers. Ask them questions instead of telling them what to do. Help them consider other possibilities, other solutions. It's important also to have a good understanding of the strengths and limitations of each team member. And this will help you determine how best to develop these individuals. And last but not least, this is for me is the most important point, which is to provide regular, ongoing feedback, both positive and or corrective. The more regular and the more ongoing the feedback is, the more likely it will have an impact on the individual, both reinforcing that particular behavior, but also correcting that behavior if need be. The sixth trait is courageous. So here, what I refer to as courage is having the courage to have these direct and tough conversations. As leaders, we all want to be liked by our team members. And as individuals as well, we want to be liked by others. But sometimes focusing too much on this and avoiding direct conversations, those really tough conversations, will have negative consequences. Tough conversations and corrective feedback, this is what enables individuals to become more accountable, to keep their focus, and also to help them develop awareness about their behavior and how their behavior is impacting the organization and others. This also helps individuals course correct if they're doing something that is not aligned with the overall vision or mission of the organization. Addressing conflict, poor performance, behaviors that are not aligned with the mission, this is very important to take a team to the next level. Avoiding these difficult conversations will inevitably have an impact on the team. More likely than not, the leader will lose credibility, and this will certainly get in the way of outstanding results. If there is an issue within a team, it's most likely that all the team members are well aware of it. So ignoring it or not addressing it is certainly going to have an impact on the reputation and credibility of a leader, and certainly on the dynamics of that team. So how can you go about having difficult conversations? For starters, conduct difficult conversations shortly after you've noticed an inappropriate behavior. And when I say inappropriate, it's a behavior that may derail success or may prevent a team or an organization from achieving a particular desired outcome. I invite you to notice your assumptions about corrective feedback. What do you believe about corrective feedback? I think we all have very strong beliefs about what this will bring up in the person receiving that feedback, discomfort, resistance, emotional reactions, even tears sometimes, anger. And this is something that most of us have a strong belief about, is the impact of corrective behavior on others, corrective feedback on others. When providing corrective feedback, declare your intention. Tell the individual why it is that you're providing them with this feedback. So for instance, you could say, my intention in providing you feedback today is because I know you have more to contribute to this team. By declaring an intention, this enables the individual to feel more trusting, to be more open to receiving that type of corrective feedback. Provide examples of behavior that you consider to be potential derailers. So the more specific you can get about behaviors that you've observed, the easier it'll be for that individual to accept your comments and also to start considering how to alter that behavior. There's a real awareness that that individual will develop around their behavior. And help individuals come up with behaviors that are more aligned with the overall mission. Invite them to consider other types of behaviors that will be more in line with what the team is trying to achieve. And here I would encourage you not to tell them what to do, but to ask them to consider alternative ways of behaving. The seventh trait is adaptive. And here I've indicated six leadership styles. This is something that was put together by Daniel Goleman. And we're going to look at each one of these styles. But exceptional leadership is the ability to juggle these six styles and identify which situation requires a particular leadership style. So let's start with the coercive style. This is typically a style that's used in a situation of turnaround or of crisis when there is a real sense of urgency and people need to comply immediately. The coercive style is one where people's sense of responsibility typically is diminished. They can't act on their own initiative. They sometimes lose their sense of ownership, and they don't feel typically very accountable for their performance. The authoritative style, this is useful when a business is adrift. It helps mobilize individuals towards a vision. The authoritative leader typically sets out a new course and sells people on a new long-term vision. The affiliative style is really about people. It believes that people come first. It's very useful for building team harmony, for increasing team morale. The affiliative manager usually uses or builds with strong emotional bonds connections with their team members. And the benefits of this type of style is really linked to team loyalty and company loyalty. A lot of positive feedback is given in this type of style. Very little, if ever, negative feedback or constructive feedback is provided in this type of style. The democratic style, this is useful to build flexibility in organization and to create more responsibility within the workforce. It enables there to be a generation of new ideas. People are more participative in this type of style. And by spending time getting people's ideas and buy-in, leaders in this type of style are able to build trust. They're also able to build respect and commitment. Pace-setting style is leadership by example. And here, this has a very positive impact, but mostly for individuals who are already self-motivated and who are highly competent. The leader here sets very high performance standards and exemplifies these standards himself. And the last style is the coaching style. This is very useful when individuals already know their weaknesses and they have a willingness and openness to improve these weaknesses. Coaching leaders typically encourage employees to establish long-term goals and to devise a plan to help them attain these goals. So again, an extraordinary leader is really able to identify what leadership style is needed for a particular situation. So how do you juggle these six different leadership styles? For starters, recognize which style is your most natural style. Usually there will be one or two styles that people are more comfortable with. It's their natural style. And really consider, instead of automatically responding to a business situation, really consider what would be the most appropriate style to use. Is it a situation of urgency, where things need to happen very quickly and people need to comply, meaning is a coercive style needed? Or is this a situation where people's morale really need to be boosted, where people need to feel like they belong, there needs to be a team environment built, or strengthened, in which case the affiliative style would be more appropriate. So I invite you to really consider for any given business situation what might be the right style to use as opposed to defaulting to your natural style. And practice these different styles until you're comfortable with most of them. And when the juggling act between the six or the four, depending on where you come out, it becomes quite natural and quite easy. The eighth trait is innovative. As I mentioned at the beginning of this call, the business world has become more competitive, more volatile. There's a lot of technical change going on, greater global competition, changing demographics of the workforce. All of these require constant change and major changes in certain circumstances within organizations. It's really necessary to survive and to compete effectively. This is why innovation is primordial. This is what enables companies to keep their competitive advantage. Change and innovation have become commonplace in the work environment today. So how do you cultivate innovation? Don't assume that the way things are being done is the best way to do them. Start challenging a lot more in terms of even business practices. Encourage creative ways of getting a new task or change effort done. Sometimes we think that innovation is about pioneering, groundbreaking ideas. In fact, innovation is really about deploying a creative mindset. It's really about using that creative muscle, which might be out of practice for some. But it's really that mindset. It's really having that creative mindset that will help you generate innovation. Create a system to harness creative ideas across all levels of the organization. As I mentioned to you, that creativity can come from different hierarchical levels. But it's important to harness these ideas because I think we all know what it's like to get very frustrated when a lot of creative ideas are being generated and none of them are being executed. And some organizations are very good at this, where they're able to generate ideas, but none of them are actually implemented. And this is what the last point addresses, is devise action plans and deadlines. Deadlines are very important here to ensure that innovative ideas are implemented and to ensure that that innovation is trickling through the organization. The ninth point is empathic. So increasing reliance on teams. As I mentioned before, there is an increasing reliance on teams today. Leaders are not working alone. And this means that leaders need to take the time to really understand the behaviors, the attitudes of their team members. This is what will enable them to achieve success. Globalization is also an element which has increased the need for empathy. There's a lot of cross-cultural dialogues occurring, and it's so easy to be misunderstood, particularly in these cross-cultural environments. And empathy is a way to really try to go beyond these barriers, go beyond these difficulties. And lastly, leaders have always needed to develop and keep good people, and this can only be done by displaying empathy. So how do you develop empathy? Practice sensing and understanding the viewpoints of people on your team. Really get to know them on a deeper level. Try even to put yourself in their shoes. Take the time to listen to the concerns of your people and really be present with them. Encourage people to speak more openly. Find out what they're thinking. Find out what's on their mind. And lastly, read between the lines and listen for unsaid messages. This is certainly something that takes practice. But if you get to know somebody on that deep level, you'll be able to understand through even physical gestures or behaviors, you'll be able to notice and be able to understand how they're feeling or even what they're thinking. extraordinary leaders are able to do this. And the last trait is authentic. And this is perhaps the most important point, and I'm sure you've heard plenty about authenticity. The majority of the traits that I've addressed here today really capture this trait. What does it mean to be authentic? As we all know, people trust leaders who are genuine, who are authentic, and not who are a replica of someone else. Now, I know that I've probably spoken about a lot of traits that don't feel very authentic to you personally. And this is why it's important for you to develop your own natural leadership style, one that resembles you, certainly incorporates some of these traits, but in your way. It's almost like a mosaic that you're putting together yourself to determine your ideal leadership style, the one that feels most natural to you. Being authentic requires the courage and the honesty to really look at one's experiences, to really see how one is showing up in the workplace. And authentic leaders always act in integrity with their values. They know who they are. They know what's important to them. And typically, they will not compromise those values. I think we all know leaders who are not authentic. Unfortunately, I think we've all been exposed to leaders who are inauthentic. And aside from the obvious, which means that their actions don't necessarily match their words, there is, really is almost a feeling that emanates, or an aura that emanates around authenticity, which leads us to be inspired by leaders who are authentic. And it's difficult to almost explain sometimes. It's the feeling that we have about whether or not someone is being authentic. And those who are not being authentic do not generate the same inspiration and the same motivation in us. So how do you exemplify authentic leadership? Demonstrate a passion for your purpose. People who are very passionate about what they do, who have very passionate messages, automatically create inspiration in others. Practice your values. Be very aware of your values, of what's important to you, and consistently lead with your heart as well as with your head. And this is a conflict that we see quite a lot in leadership. We have leaders that lead with their heart, and we have other ones that lead with their head. And sometimes it's a conflict to do both. Establishing meaningful relationships and having the self-discipline to get results. Here again, this is a conflict between the heart and the head. But it's about being able to really bring those two together that creates that authenticity. So it's about having those meaningful relationships, those deep relationships, and yet being able to convey difficult messages sometimes. Commit to developing yourself. As I mentioned, there's a lot of work in progress out there in exceptional leadership. But make it a true commitment to develop yourself. And be willing to listen to and ask for feedback, not only feedback from superiors, but also feedback from subordinates as well. Every feedback is a useful piece of information. So in conclusion, here are the traits of exceptional leaders. And I'll go through these very quickly. So visionary, they inspire others through a compelling vision they're drawn to. Achiever, approach their job with pride, creativity, a desire to learn and to achieve. Self-aware, they have the self-awareness to be honest with themselves and with others. They're social, they build bonds widely within the organization. Developer, challenge their team to come up with their own answers and help them consider other possibilities and solutions. Courageous, have tough conversations to strengthen accountability, maintain focus, and build awareness. Adaptive, they recognize which leadership style should be used in a given business situation. Innovative, cultivate innovation to build and maintain an organization's competitive advantage. Empathic, practice sensing and understanding the viewpoints of people on their team. And lastly, authentic, which is use their values consistently and lead with their heart as well as with their head. And I know this is a very long list, and as I mentioned at the beginning of the call, I hope that this is not going to create some frustration in, within you. Try to focus on one or two in particular where you know that you may need some work. At the beginning of 2011 is a great time to be doing that. So how do you redeem your free gift? You can send an email to info@intoaction.eu. If you would like the report, just indicate report in the subject line. If you'd like the newsletter, put newsletter, strategy session, strategy. If you'd like all three or any combination of the two, just indicate that in the subject line, and we will get back to you as soon as possible. I've indicated here a list of resources, which are the sources that I used and for this presentation, which I hope will be useful to you. And that's it. So thank you very much. I hope this was a useful webinar for you and that you'll be able to put some of these tips immediately to action for 2011. Over to you, Emily.
Great. Thanks so much, Celine. And just to remind everyone to submit your questions in the GoTo webinar control panel question area. And I will read those aloud to her, and she can answer as many as time will allow. Just one last reminder, we will be emailing out PowerPoint slides afterwards. I've gotten a couple questions about that, so look out for that coming in through your email box. The first question we have, Celine, is do you have any specific programs or workshops that you recommend for developing leadership skills that you've mentioned today?
It depends on where the person is located. But there's a lot of I'd rather the person email me directly and let me know exactly what they're looking for. There's all kinds of programs. Coaching is also a great way to achieve some of these, or to work on some of these leadership traits. But there's a lot of programs out there. So if the person can contact me directly, I can certainly recommend things in his or her area.
Perfect. Thank you. You talk a lot about how to set a compelling vision. Could you talk or speak to how to communicate the vision in a compelling way?
Mm-hmm. Sure. So there are several ways to communicate a vision in a compelling way. What a lot of leaders like to use are metaphors and analogies. Again, the clearer the picture, the easier it is for individuals to relate to it, to identify with it, and to be drawn into that. The other thing is also to lead by example. So it's important for leaders to really abide by that vision, meaning that there needs to be a real alignment between the vision of the leader and the actions of the leader. This is certainly something that will increase or strengthen the communication of that vision. The other thing is to repeat vision over and over again in different forums, in different formats, so that it really is something that sticks with people, something that they hear often, and something that's almost in the background of everything that they do, because effectively that's what's guiding their actions, their behaviors, their strategies.
Great. Thank you so much. The other question that we've received so far is, this is from one of our attendees. I think I have most of the 10 characteristics that you've listed, but where I see myself falling short is having self-confidence. Where do you see that among your list as importance, and do you have any suggestions on way to develop self-confidence? Mm-hmm.
So I would put the self-confidence in the realm of self-awareness. That awareness obviously is already an indication that this individual has that trait, the lack of confidence, or at least working on getting more confidence. One of the things that my coach actually told me when I first started coaching a few years ago was to act as if. With all the little voices in our heads that tell us that we're not good enough or we're not capable enough or expert enough or have enough experience or knowledge, et cetera, et cetera. To start acting as if you did have that knowledge, as if you did have that experience, and to move forward anyway. So really about acknowledging your fear, your inhibitions, facing them, and moving forward. This is also something that I work quite a bit on with clients, self-confidence. Different degrees, obviously, is something that a lot of, or lack of self-confidence, in different degrees is something that a lot of leaders face and try to overcome, some better than others in their ability to overcome their lack of self-confidence. This is really something that is, I would say, work in progress. The more risk one takes, the more one puts him or herself out there, the more likely that self-confidence will start increasing and helping that individual achieve their desired goals.
Thank you. Another question we have is, could you speak a little bit about the best way for a fallen leader to rebuild back into a leader amongst their staff and colleagues?
That's a very interesting question.
Mm-hmm.
I would need to have a little bit more background in terms of what the circumstances might have been. But I believe, as I've said in this presentation, that authenticity is key. And a fallen leader, I don't know if a mistake was made or if I don't know what the circumstances might have been, but addressing that situation with as much authenticity as possible, so recognizing mistakes, speaking about potential limitations, speaking about declaring intentions as well, and being as open and honest and authentic as possible is, for me, the best way forward. I really believe in authenticity. I think that it's difficult not to respond or not to be touched by authenticity. If somebody in front of you is sharing with you their potential limitations, their weaknesses, mistakes that they have made in the past, it's difficult to remain insensitive to that. It's difficult not to respond to it and to want to either help that person or let that person in or give that person a second chance. Again, I don't know what the circumstances of the fallen leader might have been, but that would be my approach.
Great, thank you. Another question we have is, regarding the achiever trait that you mentioned, do you have any tips on how to avoid turning people off by setting the bar too high? In other words, what do you do if your energy level is not infectious for the colleagues around you?
That's a very good point. I think we've all encountered that many times. Also, seen people that were just too energetic, let's say. I think it's important to again, it goes back to establishing all of these traits are really related, obviously. And it's important to really understand the people that you work with and understand, you know, what their motivations are, what their drives are, what their needs might be. And this will help you to either convince them of your actions or your overall vision and mission, or on the contrary, maybe identify that they would, you know, may be better suited for different work environments or in a different part of the organization. So really understanding your team members is very, very important, because this will help you determine if they're afraid to act, they're afraid of making mistakes because your standards are extremely high and they're afraid of disappointing you, or if you know, they're just not aligned, or they maybe don't understand your vision. So again, communication is extremely important, both in terms of declaring your intentions, but also understanding where they're coming from, what they need to be successful, and having what could be a difficult conversation to really enable them to provide you with the information necessary to know how to move forward and how to help them reach their potential, either with you or with somebody else.
Thank you. Another question that we have today is, how do you avoid becoming too authentic and caring about junior staff? For example, how can you manage that fine balance of understanding their perspectives, but also while maintaining authority?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's also a very interesting point, and this is why I wanted to highlight the head and the heart piece. The head for me is the results, is the outcome. The head is caring about individuals. And this is a very interesting juggling act. It's a very it's a very challenging one for certain leaders, and exceptional leaders are able to really balance both in a way that helps them achieve the outcome that they want, and yet maintain that level of familiarity or comfort, familiarity or friendship even with their staff. And I always get this question actually in coaching sessions, because I see individuals who are, I see a whole spectrum, leaders who are hesitant to become too close to their staff, other ones that feel that they are too close and therefore cannot maintain that authority. Again, those difficult conversations that I was referring to earlier, and those types of conversations are particularly difficult to have when you are dealing with people that you're very close to. But this is something that, again, is a muscle that needs to be trained, and something that you need to develop as a leader is the ability to step in and step out, meaning continuing to have that strong relationship and yet having those difficult conversations that require the demonstration of authority to ensure that objectives and results are being achieved.
Thank you. One question we have is, do you have any advice on working with a leader or boss who does not successfully have any of the traits that you have mentioned?
Do I have any advice? I certainly do. So as part of the coaching work that I do, one of the biggest learning lessons for me in working with clients was the realization that a lot of clients expect things to happen, are waiting for things to happen, waiting for promotions, waiting for their boss to change, waiting for their boss to pay attention to them, waiting for that transfer to a different country. As part of the coaching work that I do, I really encourage people to look at who they're being in a particular situation, how they're showing up. Because effectively, the only person that you can change is yourself. And you can hope that your boss will change one day, but there's no guarantees there. But I would invite you to consider how you might be able to change your behavior to cope with somebody who may not have any of these traits. Obviously, there's always the alternative of leaving that role and going to work somewhere else. But I think there's a lot to be learned from trying to deploy the skills and the even the experience that you would gain from developing tools to help you cope with what is effectively a challenging leadership style.
Thank you so much. Looks like we have time for one last question. This is an interesting one, and more of opinionated, but do you feel like gender still plays a role in leadership and or affects someone's ability to become a leader?
That's a very interesting question indeed. It's interesting because I've seen so many different types of leaders, and you know, some leaders that had more, you know, the stereotype would indicate that these types of, you know, empathic traits and self-awareness, and also the ability to really be social and connect with others, you would think they're more feminine traits. I mean, that's obviously a stereotype that I'm putting out there for the sake of this argument. But in reality, it's, you know, I've seen if these are more feminine traits, let's say, I've seen leaders who are women who don't have these traits, or who don't display them as readily as men might. And so I don't know that there is a generalization per se, and I don't know that there are typical behaviors that can be attributed to a certain gender or another. Again, I think exceptional leadership is really about setting out an intention to be an exceptional leadership and to start exercising those muscles or that awareness that we might not use on a regular basis. And I think anyone is capable of doing that. Obviously, I wouldn't be a coach if I didn't believe that. And so it's really about how important it is to you to start making some of these changes and to start behaving in a different way to create the results that can be achieved through exceptional leadership.
Thank you so much. That's a great response. Well, I want to take this opportunity to thank you, Celine, for your time and sharing your expertise with our alumni today. Today's webinar has been great. And also to remind everyone on the line that we'll be sending an email out afterwards with the slides and also details on how to access an archive of this webinar later on this week. We will also love your feedback, so if you have a couple minutes, please take our survey that will be included in the email. And I'm going to turn it over to Celine to see if she has any last-minute comments.
Okay. Well, thank you all for listening in on this webinar. I know it's not always an easy forum to follow, but in any case, I do want to reiterate the fact that exceptional leadership is something that is achievable and attainable by everyone. Sure, there are the natural-born leaders out there who are charismatic, but it's not because they're charismatic that they're necessarily the best leaders. They may be missing a lot of other traits. I think they just look like good leaders because they have those that charisma. So I would encourage you to really declare an intention and, again, look at one or two of these traits and really focus on them, at least for the first few months of 2011, and see what it yields. So a happy new year to all again, and thank you for listening to this webinar.
Thank you so much. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.